So I think we should probably begin our lecture tonight. And Blaine, thank you so much. It is so nice to bring those because I forgot them and left them at the office. So I'm just going to pass around the handout. For those of you who may not know, I'm Dr. Lucinda Bateman, and I am the executive director of Offer, which is a nonprofit we were talking about, and Offer sponsors these monthly meetings. And tonight I wanted to talk about the challenge of disordered sleep. Now, sleep is a huge topic. We could do an entire week of lectures on sleep. So I decided to make this a rather practical talk about sleep in CFS and fibro. And you're welcome to ask me questions as we go or at the end. And then maybe we can kind of relate it to each of you as we go. I want to start the talk with a little bit of introduction about sleep stages. And I'm sure you've heard a little bit about this before. There are four stages of sleep plus REM sleep. And in each stage, the body and the brain act differently. And during the different stages of sleep, different things happen to replenish the nervous system, neurotransmitters and hormones and various things. And you cycle through these stages throughout the night. And I want to talk a little bit more about each stage. So stage one sleep is when you're kind of falling asleep. You ever had that feeling of falling and jerking or having your muscles jerk? That's called stage one sleep. And it's just the beginnings of your body relaxing. Very, very light sleep. Stage two sleep involves about 50% of the night. And I would consider stage two sleep to be probably light sleep. When we send someone for a sleep study, the majority of the night is usually stage two sleep because they're all wired up and they're sleeping in a strange place, and it's very hard to get relaxed and have deep sleep when you're in the sleep lab. I'm sorry about my voice. A month ago I had this bug going around and it just trashed my vocal cords, so when I try to project or talk, then it makes my vocal cords go into spasm. So excuse my coffee. Stage three sleep is the first stage of deep sleep, and this is the stage where you start to have delta waves, and I'm going to show you a little picture of what delta waves are. But delta waves are really slow, relaxed waves of sleep, and when you get into stage three and four sleep, sometimes it's hard to wake up. You know, have you ever been awakened from sleep and just feel like you don't know who you are and where you've been and you're very confused? Usually that's because you were actually in deep sleep. And stage three and four sleep are often kind of lumped together. In these deep stages of sleep, these slow delta waves are almost the only waves. And it's very, very important to have stage three and four sleep to wake up feeling refreshed and also to cycle into REM sleep. And if these stages are too short, your sleep doesn't feel satisfying. If you don't have stage three and four sleep, or you don't have enough deep sleep, you will awaken feeling unrefreshed. Now, REM sleep is a very odd stage of sleep that's inserted several times during the night. It's called rapid eye movement sleep. And this is the stage of sleep where you dream. And the eyes move back and forth and you dream, but strangely enough, during this stage of sleep, certain neurotransmitters stop firing. And you don't fire norepinephrine and serotonin, and your body doesn't move at all, even though your brain is very active and your eyes may move. And about 20% of sleep is REM sleep, and we don't really totally understand what the purpose of REM sleep is. But we know that if you don't get enough REM sleep, then the next time your body craves REM sleep, and if you don't get deep sleep and REM sleep, the next time you go to sleep, sometimes the REM sleep will crowd to the beginning and it will get out of order. And I think that may be why people who are sleep deprived or under a lot of stress have vivid, chaotic dreams at all times of the night because their REM sleep is very disrupted. So there have been studies in patients with fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome, but not enough studies, and there may be so much heterogeneity or diversity among patients that it's difficult to generalize. I would say the best studies have been done in fibromyalgia patients. And we know that two things occur very regularly in fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. One is what we call alpha wave intrusion. And alpha waves are the opposite of the delta waves. Delta waves are those quiet waves of deep sleep. Alpha waves are waves that are associated with being awake. So a part of your brain is awake and firing, and these alpha waves break through. So when they're doing an EEG, when you should be asleep, the brain is awake, or at least part of the brain. And we also know that there's inadequate stage 3 and 4 sleep, that people don't get into deep sleep. And this is a picture of EEG waves. And if you look to the far right, see that the amplitude of the waves is very, very small, and there's kind of a wavy effect. That's the delta waves. And if you look in the middle, there's something called a K wave, which is the big one that looks like an EKG wave. But then can you see the jaggedy lines in the middle? Those are the alpha waves. So this is a little burst of alpha activity interrupting normal delta sleep. And this is a slide that shows the presence of alpha waves in fibromyalgia patients. They took a group of patients who would awaken feeling achy after a night of sleep. And you can see on the left bar that 100% of the patients had phasic alpha. That means they had bursts of alpha waves all through the night. Phasic meaning, come and go and come and go. And 25% had tonic alpha. That means it was just constant alpha waves throughout the whole night. And 58% had low alpha. And I don't think we need to overanalyze this slide, but you can see that alpha waves are very prominent in fibromyalgia patients. And this basically demonstrates that fibro patients don't go into deep sleep, and a part of their brain remains awake during sleep. I would say from my clinical experience that disturbed or unrefreshing sleep is almost universal in patients with CFS and fibro. It's in the case definition of CFS, and everybody who understands fibro and sees patients clinically will say that there's some problem with sleep. And I would also say that as people get well and go along with their illness, usually the last thing to go is medication for sleep. And most people, even when they're doing very well, maintain on just something to straighten out their sleep waves. To me, that is the best evidence that there's some intrinsic problem with normal restorative sleep in patients with CFS and fibro. Now, when you take all comers, I mean, I just sat down and made this list. Sleep cycle disruption. So some people's sleep is upside down. They sleep in the day and can't sleep at night. This particularly happens to adolescents when they get sick. First, they sleep all the time after they have their mono, and then they get turned upside down and they can't sleep at night. And then they'll finally go to sleep really early in the morning and sleep all day. And I had this one kid who just said he would roll over. And I said, what do you mean roll over? And after this happened for several days, he'd just sleep for 24 hours straight and then get up at the right time. They called that rolling over because he couldn't straighten his sleep cycles out without just sleeping through a whole 24-hour cycle and then trying to get up at the right time the next morning. Trouble falling asleep, of course, light sleep. Nighttime awakenings, trouble falling back to sleep, movement disorders, early morning awakening, and almost universal is trouble waking up after finally getting to sleep. It seems to be that it takes so long to get into deep sleep or to start to get into normal sleep cycles, if you ever do, that then it's difficult to wake up. And it's really hard for people to kick back in and get their brain working in the morning. It's like they can't wake up once they've been asleep. And many patients have primary sleep disorders as well. I'll talk to you about what primary sleep disorders in just a minute, what they are. I put in, this is how I ask about sleep in my clinic. And if you think about 0 is never having a symptom, and 3 is that it's a constant severe symptom. Number 2 would be it's a moderate symptom, and number 1 is mild and doesn't happen very often. This would be, so I look at these numbers to try to help communicate to me what kind of a problem people are having to sleep. People say, I can't sleep, and I have no idea what that means when they come in, because it could mean any of those things. So when you communicate to your medical providers, you need to learn how to communicate what parts of your sleep aren't working right. So this person can't get to sleep, wakes up too early, and can't get back to sleep if they wake up. And that sounds a lot like someone with depression. or other kinds of severe insomnia. And this is a person who sleeps all the time. I have people circle that their sleep is horrible, and what they really mean is they just sleep all the time. They need too much, they need to take naps, but they never feel refreshed, and so they feel like their sleep is abnormal. And this is a person with movement disorder. So they've got leg cramps and jerks and restless legs, and their sleep is unrefreshing and restless when they try to sleep. So you can see that even with this number of questions, it takes a little bit of talking to try to communicate or even identify for yourself exactly what the problem is with your sleep. So let's take a minute and talk about what are called primary sleep disorders. These are disorders that if you went to a sleep specialist, they would have a name for it, and they would be able to, you know, treat it independently of your CFS or fibro. And these are the main ones. These are movement disorders, restless legs and periodic limb movement. These are people that move in their sleep, either as you're going to sleep, before sleep, or during sleep. And this can be picked up during the polysomnography, which is the diagnostic test of sleep. How many people here have undergone polysomnography? Okay, so we have a lot of people who have kind of had that difficult artificial experience where, you know, they put EEG leads and an EKG monitor and people are spying on you, and then they tell you, oh, relax and go have a good night's sleep and we'll try to study your sleep cycles. And I've listed some examples of medications that might be used in these kind of sleep disorders just for reference. Now, obstructive sleep apnea and upper airway resistance syndrome are extremely common. And these are conditions where usually the airways or some other obstruction interferes with breathing. And although we say people stop breathing, what happens is people underbreathe, or they'll breathe less and less and then kind of stop breathing until all the bells and whistles go off in the brain and stimulate a big snorty breath, and then people get back to breathing. So what it does, sometimes it can drop the oxygen levels to levels that can become dangerous for your heart and lungs and your brain. But most importantly, it wakes you up many, 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 many times during the night, so you're not able to get into stage 3 and 4 sleep. And these kind of obstructive syndromes, and UARS is a milder form of obstruction that doesn't always warrant the more expensive CPAP and BiPAP. Maybe some a little bit less, a little more moderate measures. But, you know, we use a lot of different interventions to see if we can help people breathe better during the night. Sometimes just sleeping on your side instead of on your back is enough to improve sleep apnea. You really need to treat sinus issues. And sometimes people actually have surgery on their palate. And other times weight loss is helpful because the extra weight creates obstruction. But these devices allow more air pressure so that the breathing is a little bit easier and the body is more likely to take a breath in and continue having normal breathing during the night. It's not easy to wear this equipment during the night, but people that have significant symptoms from their disease will tell you that if they're consistent with wearing their equipment and get used to their equipment, that the many aspects of their syndrome become better. You can help headaches, fatigue, depression, high blood pressure, swelling and edema, and cognition, brain fog, simply by treating sleep apnea during the night. And you can imagine that if you have obstructive sleep apnea on top of your fibromyalgia or CFS, that it's very important to identify it and to try to treat it the best we can. Sometimes it's not easy to compensate, and we try all those things and we only partially compensate the problem. Now, central sleep apnea is a little different animal, and this is a lack of drive to breathe from the neurologic system, from the brain. And this doesn't usually happen naturally. It can happen with injury to the brain. It usually happens because we take medicines that suppress the respiratory drive or, you know, quiet your brain. And the most common ones are opioids and benzodiazepines. That's like Xanax and clonazepam and Valium. And drugs we use for anxiety, and even the drugs we use for restless legs, in some cases can suppress your respiratory drive. Certainly the opioids are the most dangerous and the most likely to suppress your respiratory drive. And you can't treat that with CPAP, because if you don't take a breath in, if you don't have a drive to breathe, the CPAP is not going to help you. The CPAP simply increases the airway pressure so that when you try to take a breath, it more easily passes. And narcolepsy, central sleep apnea is treated by trying to reduce the factors, reduce the medicines that are aggravating the central sleep apnea. And in our effort to treat pain in a lot of patients, we've put people on opioids to control their pain and created sleep apnea or central sleep apnea, which compounds their illness. So this becomes one of the dilemmas of trying to treat a chronic illness. Now, narcolepsy is a relatively rare illness that's characterized by fragmented sleep at night. The patients don't get into normal sleep cycles at night, and then they're sleepy all day long, so they tend to catnap. And this kind of a disease is demonstrated by what's called a multiple sleep latency test. It's just a test where they have you take naps during the day, and they see how long it takes you to go to sleep. And in a normal person, it takes 15 to 20 minutes to go to sleep. And in someone with narcolepsy, they might fall asleep in 3 minutes, three or 4 minutes each time they lay down to take a nap. They're very sleep deprived, and the illness is treated either by consolidating sleep with appropriate sleep medicines or with stimulants during the day, like Provigil, or sometimes both. So we do screen for narcolepsy, and I have diagnosed it several times in patients in my clinic. So this is a slide I took from one of my other talks. This is a slide I've given to many patient groups, but also to many, many physician groups. And that is, when I'm looking at a patient with CFS or fibro, I have sort of a hierarchy of how I address their symptoms. And the symptom on the top is always sleep. It is one of the most important symptoms. Now, this assumes that patients are pacing. You know what pacing means? Kind of regulating your activity, not overdoing. That's like the primo most important thing to do. But sleep and analyzing sleep, diagnosing what's wrong with it, and trying to restore sleep to as good of an approximation of real sleep as you can. And then we go down the line. And I don't know if you've seen this diagram before or if I've used it, but this is just a simple diagram I use when I'm talking to doctors about managing CFS and fibro. And that is, the fatigue and your function really rest very strongly on managing the four legs of the table. And the four legs of the table, notice which one's in front, sleep. And, you know, reducing stress and treating mood symptoms on that side. Managing severe pain is imperative. And in the back is not getting too deconditioned and keeping your body strong and trying to do as much as you can physically without aggravating your illness. And each one of those aggravates the other. So if you have too much pain, you can't sleep. If your mood symptoms are, you know, raging, you don't sleep. Even deconditioning can aggravate sleep if you gain weight or if it increases your pain. And we know that appropriate exercise, you know, really helps people sleep better, as long as it's not overdone. So this is an important paradigm, and we're going to come back to it.
Could you clarify the phrase orthostatic
intolerance? I can. It's sort of peripheral to what we're talking about. I just stole this slide. Orthostatic intolerance is a family of illnesses that have to do with rapid heart rate and drop in blood pressure and feeling dizzy when you stand up. And I put that at the bottom because in many patients, you also have to remember to treat the orthostatic intolerance. But thank you for that. So we're going to come at this a few ways, and you might be thinking about your own sleep disorder. Are the your medicines that you take for sleep, or all the other medicines you take that might impact your sleep. These are two golden rules I have when we're trying to think about sleep. One is, if you're going to treat sleep, you should try to treat the problems that you're having with sleep. Don't just bomb yourself with stuff to make you go to sleep. Try to figure out why you're not sleeping and aim your treatment at that problem. So, and I put poor sleep hygiene first because I am stunned and amazed by people's sleep habits when I start to ask them about them. And that means staying up too late, staying on the computer, not going to bed, eating in bed and having cracker crumbs all around, going to sleep with the TV on. And people who can't sleep develop very bad sleep hygiene because you get in the habit of not being able to go to sleep. And pretty soon, you know, you're doing all these dysfunctional things around sleep. And I'll tell you, sleep is the most suggestive symptom. And that is, as soon as you think you're not going to be able to sleep, it's 10 times harder to go to sleep. Because just thinking that it's a problem, you know, disrupts the normal relaxation and pattern of sleep. So it's a big problem. Medications, we're going to go through some of these later in the talk. Restless legs, racing thoughts, worries, pain, snoring, bed partners who snore, bed partners who stay up too late or make too much noise, coughing, reflux, congestion, getting up to go to the bathroom. I mean, you see, there are many, many, many sleep disruptors, and you should analyze your own sleep and see how many of these things you can aim at to make your sleep better, as opposed to just taking a whole slug of medicine to sleep through it. Does that make sense? The next thing is, there's really a difference between initiating sleep and sustaining sleep in terms of the way we use medications. And some people just can't get to sleep, and if they can get to sleep, they stay asleep all night. That is the exception, actually, in this group of patients. And for those people, a drug like Lunesta or Ambien, one of those really short-acting meds, is perfect because it puts you into deeper sleep, and once you're asleep, you stay asleep. But for most of my crowd, they'll come in and say, Ambien doesn't work for me. And I'll say, what do you mean it doesn't work for you? And they'll say, well, in 4 hours I wake up. And I say, Ambien worked perfectly for you. That's what Ambien does. Ambien works for 4 hours. But if you have the kind of a sleep problem that is there all night, then just initiating sleep is not going to be enough for you. And what you need to do is think about, you know, whether or not you need something all night long to treat a symptom that's disrupting your sleep, or whether you just, and other people are fine unless they get awakened. And then I have people come in who say, you know, I wake up at 4 a.m. and I took Tylenol, 2 Tylenol p.m. And then they wonder why they feel horrible all day long, because that drug lasts way too long. And if they want to take something to get back to sleep, they need to take just a touch of something that's only going to last 3 or 4 hours. Does that make sense? So you really have to be savvy about the kind of medications you take for sleep, or you're going to make your day a lot worse, either by having medicines that spill over into the day or having to take too many medicines and not effectively treating your sleep. So these are just some pointers on sleep hygiene. You can learn about sleep hygiene in many, many places. You can get on the internet and put good sleep hygiene and find many, many good resources. The challenge is implementing it and being very consistent with it. But you want to set a regular pattern of getting to bed and getting up. That is very important. That's something that doesn't always occur. Create a good sleep environment. Reduce noise and distractions. You need to be very careful about napping too much during the day. If you take long naps, particularly late in the day, you've disrupted your sleep cycle. So when it's time to go to bed, your brain is not going to be ready to go to sleep. So you need to try to consolidate your sleep at night if you can. If you're too ill to go through the day without napping, try to rest and hydrate rather than sleep. And if you must sleep, try to sleep for shorter periods of time and a little earlier in the day rather than late, so that it gets too close to the nighttime for sleep. Well, I guess it depends on how it impacts you. If you can do it without it bothering your sleep, then it doesn't matter, right? If you can sleep fine that night without a whole bunch of medicines and stuff, but if you find you can't get to sleep, then you probably slept too long. And there's quite a list of medications that can interfere with sleep. And one of them is caffeine. Decongestants, I don't know how many times I've stopped people's decongestant. So, you know, Allegra D, Claritin D, Zyrtec D, that D, that big D is a decongestant. It's like pseudoephedrine. It's like adrenaline. And they come in these huge, whopping, sustained release pills. And I don't know how many people I've improved their sleep by 50% just by taking them off their decongestant that keeps their brain active like this all night long.
It was suggested to me that I stop using caffeine and go to Provigil. But isn't that a similar mechanism?
It's a different mechanism, but if you have problems with sleep, I want to tell you that Provigil has a very long half-life. I'll tell you, when Provigil first came out, this is my confession, this is not a controlled substance, but I thought, I'm going to try that. Go to the sample cupboard. I broke a Provigil in half and took it first thing in the morning. And 10 o'clock that night, I was, And instead of falling into my bed at 10, you know, I was reading until 11. And then I finally went to sleep, but it was kind of light sleep. And then I woke up at 6, so I felt great, I'm getting up. I mean, those provigil levels were in me for 24 hours, I'm sure, maybe a little bit longer. And I woke up, I felt, you know, a little bit alert, and I got by on like 5 hours of sleep instead of my usual 8 hours of sleep. So provigil, I'm sure, is long enough to impact some people's sleep. Well, Butrin, I put ephedrine up there because many people take ephedrine over the counter, and ephedrine's been banned. Now you don't see it as much, but it's sneaking back in smaller amounts and in certain ways. Ephedrine is a very powerful stimulant. Well, Butrin, I keep that way in the beginning of the day. I would never take Wellbutrin in the afternoon or late in the day or before going to bed. It's a great antidepressant. Sometimes we don't think about opioids, but opioids can be very problematic for sleep. Not all opioids, certain ones. I mean, if I take a hydrocodone, like I have a cough or a cold medicine, I am just boing, you know, my mind is inventing things all night long. And so you do need to be aware of that. And the other mistake people make is using alcohol to sleep. Now, alcohol is a relaxant, and it will help you for a little while. But in about 4 hours, when the levels come down, you get CNS, central nervous system stimulation, and you get restless and awake. So sometimes if you try to drink alcohol to go to sleep, you'll wake up in the middle of the night and not be able to go back to sleep. So it's not really a good kind of a sleep medicine. Of course, you develop tolerance to it and other health problems related to it. I'm not saying you'd never drink any alcohol, but you need to be careful about using it to try to sleep.
When you say using it to try to sleep, how much earlier in the day is it going to affect you?
I think you'll have to experiment a little bit, but I think people, pay attention. And if in 4 hours or so after you consume it, you find your eyes popping open, then you may be having that rebound from alcohol. It might be a little different in different people. But people can get restless legs and certainly have a waking up period when that alcohol wears off.
I thought it helped me if I have it with a meal, not much.
Well, I think sometimes a drink in the evening or with dinner is relaxing and helps people wind down. And I think that's why you have to just use it, you know, with wisdom and individually for your own circumstance. I'm just giving you clues to think about your own patterns and maybe you'll find some things that aren't working for you, and everybody's a little bit different, right? So general recommendations, avoid caffeine afternoon. Do you know that caffeine has a 5-hour half-life? That means if you 5 hours after you have consumed it, half of it is still in your bloodstream. In 10 hours after you consumed it, a quarter of it is still in your bloodstream. So if you're very sensitive to caffeine, even caffeine in the morning could interrupt your sleep. But certainly caffeine in the afternoon is going to, could definitely impact your sleep. You should think about your medicines, improve your sleep hygiene, think about just the right amount of exercise that's going to help you become a little bit tired, but not overtired or in relapse. We talked about naps, the cause of sleep disruption and alcohol. Just a little summary slide. Now, lest we get too carried away with meds, we're going to talk about medications. I want to say that natural sleep is the best sleep. And whatever you can do to return to normal sleep should be a high priority for everyone. No drugs, no substances. You can do it with sleep hygiene and all the things we talk about. I'm also convinced that if we don't correct abnormal sleep, that people have a bigger disease burden. And if a lot of people say, I don't want to take any meds, and then their sleep is very disrupted, and chronically disrupted sleep causes pain and fatigue and brain fog, and it may even be the cause of fibromyalgia pain, chronically disrupted sleep. So it's insidiously harmful to have chronic sleep deprivation. So with that in mind, we have to remember that if we choose to use medicines, every medicine has pros and cons. And while medicines help your sleep, there's usually something deleterious to your sleep about almost every medication we take for sleep. So let's think about that while we talk about medications. All right, so this first list is example of medicines that I think of as sleep initiators. Medicines we use to try to put your brain to sleep. And Ambien is the shortest acting of these drugs. Very quick to act and very short duration. It's so powerful that your brain is asleep even if your body is up and moving around. And the worst things that happen from people using Ambien are they take their Ambien and they don't get in bed. And they make decisions like picking up their car keys and driving. And I've had, once you take your Ambien, it's like having a couple of drinks, right? Your judgment about things has been altered. So you need to be very careful when you take an Ambien that your toe is in the bed and that you don't get up and make phone calls and try to do important things, and especially never, never, never get behind the wheel of a car. And otherwise, it's a pretty safe medicine. Some people get up and eat. One part of their brain is hungry and, you know, festering and thinking they might want something, and the other part goes to sleep. And the hungry part gets up and the sleep part keeps them awake, and they wake up in the morning and their bed is full of crumbs and they've been eating in their bed. So Ambien and Sonata are very short acting, and Lunesta a little bit longer. Restoril is in the family of benzodiazepines, temazepam, and there's several medicines in that family. They are the old-fashioned sleep medicines we used before the top three were invented. And the biggest problem with them is that you develop tolerance and habituation. And when you try to pull back, you have very severe insomnia from trying to come off of them. Melatonin and Roseron work on melatonin receptors, and they theoretically help you reset your sleep cycles. They're not potent medicines to conk you out and make you go to sleep.
Has Ambien been proven to be habit-forming, or is it psychologically habit-forming? I mean, you become dependent upon it because I know in my own case, I feel like I can't get to sleep unless I take my Ambien.
Yeah, I think it's a complex process that involves both things. It's not habituating in the way benzodiazepines or opioids are, where you have a physical withdrawal from stopping the medicine, but you do get sleep rebound from these medicines, which means when you try to stop them, you don't sleep as well for some nights. And it's kind of frightening, and you think, oh my gosh, I can't sleep, and then can't sleep, and then it's amplified. So there's also, there's a psychological part of sleep, of pulling back from those medicines, and then there's also a rebound that's not technically a true withdrawal. The other thing to remember is you may just have an intractable sleep problem. So when you stop your sleeping meds, your sleep problem is there again. And a lot of times it's kind of a fine line to know the difference between, you know, kind of a dependence on your sleep medicines and a persistent sleep problem that's still there when you stop the medicine. Yes?
Is melatonin completely safe to use, and if so, what amounts?
I think it's relatively safe. And I couldn't tell you the amounts. Actually, it's over the counter, so I never prescribe it. And I think whatever's advised over the counter. You know, it blocks serotonin receptors, and it's never been very intuitive to me as being the right kind of a medicine for my patients. But some people with mild sleep problems find melatonin to be helpful. I think, from what I understand of the physiology of melatonin, it would make more sense to use it in phases, like when you when you travel and you have changes in your sleep timing, and you want to reset your clock, and you take it for a while until you get back on cycle. Some people find it pretty sedating, but to be honest, I don't know how much of that is suggestion. I talked to someone today who said her amitriptyline conked her out every night within a minute of getting into bed. And I said, well, what time do you take your amitriptyline? Right as I get into bed. And I said, there's no way your amitriptyline can be putting you to sleep 1 minute after you get into bed. I go right to sleep. I just love that drug. And I thought, she loves it so much, she's so confident she's going to go to sleep, that she goes right to sleep. And then probably in the next 20, 30, you know, 45 minutes, the Ambien gets absorbed, I mean, the amitriptyline gets absorbed and starts to help her sleep. So you can see how suggestive it is. Theoretically, Roseron should be a very good medicine. And I just have not had great success with it in my practice. But it is a synthetic version of what melatonin might be. An agonist is like a mimic at the receptor. So this is a drug that triggers the action of melatonin at the receptors. And maybe for sleep cycle disorders and very straightforward issues in some people, it's a useful drug. And Xyrem is, have you heard of GHB or the date rape drug? That drug that was taken and developed as a pharmaceutical because it's such a good medicine for sleep. And it's thought that this medicine may restore the most normal deep sleep of any medicine on the market. But because of its history, it's tightly controlled. It's also difficult because it's in a liquid form and it only works for 3 or 4 hours, and you have to wake up and take a second dose in order to get your full 8 hours of sleep. There has been a clinical trial done in fibromyalgia, and I've had a little sneak peek at the results, and it looks like it's going to be helpful for reducing pain in fibromyalgia in a competitive way to some of the other drugs that have been approved for fibro. Okay, any questions about these sort of sleep-initiating drugs?
Taking some of these medications, because for me personally, the melatonin actually, like you said, the serotonin levels are lower. It actually made me feel horribly sad and bummed out, and I just refused to take it for that reason.
You know, I don't hear it very often, but definitely somebody reports something from almost every drug, some kind of intolerance, or, you know, I've had people tell me that even though Ambien is a very short-acting drug, that they feel like they have altered cognition all day long. And while it has a very short half-life, that drug does not disappear during the day. It's at very low levels because the drugs are very slowly metabolized, and sometimes just a tiny bit is enough to take the edge off people's cognition, and they just don't want to do that during the day. So it really varies from person to person.
You mentioned Tylenol PM, and I don't use, but Advil PM.
So the PM...
I understand that's Benadryl.
It's usually Benadryl or another antihistamine, and the properties of antihistamines are that they are sedating, and they're considered relatively safe, although the anticholinergic side effects in people as you age can become very problematic, and can even cause cognitive issues and dry mouth and constipation. So while it's considered very safe enough to be used over the counter as a sleep aid, it's not without its problems. And you know, it's very long-acting. Some people don't get tired at all from antihistamines, and some people are knocked out. If I take 25 milligrams of Benadryl at night, I do not feel clear until after noon, maybe 2 o'clock the next day.
Yeah, I know.
From a small dose.
You mentioned you took 2, and when I took 2, I didn't function the next day, but if I take 1, then sometimes it helps. But
yeah,
so you kind of get used to it, and then it doesn't
work. And then it doesn't work as well, right. Well, let's do, okay, go ahead. Let's go to another page.
I just made a comment on that, too. I think, you know, men and women are obviously different, but you take those with men and you got prostate problems, and it just compounds everything.
There you go. So those are anticholinergic side effects from those drugs that can aggravate prostate problems, and those things are individual, but if they happen to you, it's huge. It's a very big problem, and sometimes you don't relate it to the med. You don't realize that the medication is causing those symptoms. Okay, so this is a list of medicines that I would, they're not really sleeping pills, right? They're medicines that make you sleepy, so we use them for sleep. And since they've been approved for long-term or daily use for some other kind of a problem, it makes sense that they would be something safe that you could take every night for sleep. And I have to tease doctors sometimes because this is the only area of medicine where the FDA-approved drugs for sleep are discouraged, and all off-label use is encouraged, right? Your doctor says, oh, you don't take too much of that Ambien, and the insurance company won't pay for it. The only drugs that actually been studied and proven as safe for sleep are the ones that everybody worries about. And in some cases, doctors are trained, don't ever use drugs that aren't approved by the FDA, except when it comes to sleep. And we always prescribe drugs that aren't really approved for sleep. So, go figure. So, the old-fashioned drugs, amitriptyline and doxepin, again, very high in those anticholinergic side effects, but very much like taking an antihistamine, but they're super inexpensive, and they help with pain. So, some people find that a small dose of amitriptyline is perfect for sleep, and other people find it to be intolerable for some reason.
Amitriptyline, is that... been related to weight gain also?
Amitriptyline can be associated with weight gain, but really depending on the dose. So the higher the dose, the more the weight gain. Trazodone is a tried and true old antidepressant that's very safe and very sedating, and lots of people use trazodone very successfully. The newer drugs, the anticonvulsants like Lyrica and Neurontin, Topamax, Zonegran, these are medicines that are very helpful for pain. Some of them are good mood stabilizers, and because they're sedating, you can take them at night and it helps relieve your pain during the night, kind of makes you sleepy, and you have a better night because of the experience of having those symptoms relieved. The atypicals are called atypical antipsychotics. This is the family they came from. They're mostly used for anxiety and as mood stabilizers in bipolar illness, but they're great drugs for sleep. Zyprexa and Seroquel. Now, Zyprexa is associated with severe weight gain in the higher doses and in people who are prone to weight gain and diabetes, but it is the most beautiful medicine for sleep. So, and they're quite expensive, these drugs, because they don't come in generic yet, but Seroquel and Zyprexa, when they came on the market, I finally could treat sleep and some of my most recalcitrant, difficult insomniacs in my practice. Mm-hmm. Benzodiazepines are up there. They're problematic. I really don't think you should rely on benzodiazepines for sleep unless you have a movement disorder, you know, of restless legs or jerking, or if you have a significant anxiety disorder and that is the drug of choice for treating your anxiety. But benzodiazepines alter sleep cycles, phases, and are not necessarily the best medicines for sleep. And you develop tolerance to them and they don't work as well. They're really designed for anxiety. So when you first start using them, they work well for sleep, but after you've used them for a long time, they're just not as good. Clonazepam has a 24-hour half-life. So that means in the morning when you wake up, it hasn't even diminished very much in your blood, and it's only half metabolized in 24 hours from when you take it. So taking it just for sleep doesn't make sense. Now, if you have restless legs during the night or jerks, or you're using it to quiet your central nervous system for some other reason, then round-the-clock coverage is appropriate. That makes sense? But I wouldn't pick it simply as a sleep medicine. And then muscle relaxants are on the list, and cyclobenzaprine, which is Flexeril, is a lot like tricyclic medicines like amitriptyline. And Xanaflex is a, there are quite a few published papers on using tizanidine, which is Xanaflex, at night. And get the dose up, pain is relieved, sleep a little bit. You have to be careful with some of these medicines that if you get up too quickly during the night, you'll have orthostatic hypotension. You'll feel dizzy, like you might black out. So you need to be very careful of that.
What if you're on several of these at pretty high, some even extremely high, multiples, and exhausted all day? Know you're exhausted specifically because of them, and doctors are because of it, and all of that, and still at night, you're having huge trouble getting that night that you fall asleep to find. Anything you can say about maintaining the
game? No, I just think, I don't know, we have to individualize treatment, and certainly I have people on more than one drug for sleep at night sometimes. You should take everything you learned tonight and go through it with a fine-tooth comb and see if you can improve your regimen. No magic. I think treating sleep in CFS and fibro is the most challenging aspect of this illness for those very reasons. Is sleep is difficult and medicines aren't perfect, and the more you take, the more fatigue you have and brain fog you have during the day, and the more you upset your sleep cycles because you're not active and awake and alert during the day. And I have one patient, she's young, she's about 30 years old. When she came to me, she was diagnosed with a psychotic disorder, but she had CFS and she was so sleep deprived that she was goofy. She was almost psychotic, but not really. She didn't have a primary psychiatric disorder. And we have her on 4 medicines at night. And actually, I think she takes a full dose of trazodone. She takes a pretty good dose of Zyprexa. She does take a benzo. And then she has to initiate sleep with Lunesta or Ambien. Now, I would not preach that, but I'll tell you, we went through long hours and days and months of trying to figure out how to get her sleeping, and once we got her sleeping, her function came up tremendously and she was doing a lot better. That is a very individual case, very unusual case.
Flexeril, just to clarify, is that
I've had that a couple of times because of pulled muscles that typically you get now and then. It does help me get to sleep, but it seems to, as the prescription runs out, it has less effect. And
Yeah. One of the things about Flexeril is it's really potent for sleep the first night.
Yeah.
And that goes about by half every night after that.
Yeah.
And some people find it to be great every night, and other people take it three times a day for their muscle strain. So you can see there's a big variability. Okay, any other questions about these meds?
You passed over trazodone really quickly because you said it's the old tried true. Are there bad side effects?
The only side effect to trazodone is that some people get a hangover from it. So really the key to using these longer active medicines is to take them early as you can. So they're really starting to work and help you get sleepy, and you kind of shift their length back so that they're more likely to be clearing in the morning when you want to get up. Don't wait and take them right when you go to bed. They won't work very fast. You're going to have to take something else to go to sleep.
Say 10 hours after you've taken them, they're pretty much.
They start to go. Yeah, and the longer you're on them, the better it gets. So you've got to be patient. And then use the doses as low as you can so they don't have as much hangover during the day. And it's just quite individual. But it's really a great medicine. It's pennies. It's so inexpensive. And it doesn't have any toxicities for most people. Has fewer anticholinergic side effects than tricyclics. Doesn't cause weight gain in most people. So it's really a good drug if you can get by with the daytime sedation that might occur in some patients.
Clonazepam, 2 milligrams long-term? Sounds like a lot compared to your chart there.
Yeah, it is. And the problem with all the benzos is no matter what dose you take, you will develop tolerance to that dose.
Okay.
And then to get it to work, you're going to have to increase the dose. And that happens endlessly.
But if I've been like on 2 milligrams for like a year and a half, and I adjust it maybe a week, I'm thinking I'm going through these withdrawals maybe because I'm going off of it.
So yeah, if you're trying to make a change in clonazepam because of its long half-life,
right,
it's going to take 4 or 5 days to really feel the impact of your change. It takes 4 to 5 half-lives of a drug to bottom out and have your levels completely flatten out. And so sometimes people will make a change and they don't realize why they feel horrible 4 or 5 days later.
Yes.
And when you try to come off benzodiazepines, all the central sensitivity of CFS and fibro gets worse. Your restless legs get worse, you feel nervous, you can't sleep, you can't relax, you know, your irritable bowel comes back, and all these things that have been, you know, tempered by the drug come up in withdrawal. Now, if you can make it through, you can get off the drug, but it takes a long time. And so I usually suggest that you make your changes really slowly. And also, clonazepam is not as much of a problem, but some of the other benzodiazepines, if you've been on quite a big dose, you could actually have a seizure if you went off quickly off your benzodiazepines. That's why the habituation to those drugs has to be taken more seriously. So someone on high doses of Xanax or the sleep meds, if you're taking big high dose and you stop it suddenly, you can become quite ill. I saw another hand somewhere.
Right here. There's one anticonvulsant too that my neurologist allowed me to use, trying to get good sleep when I have to after I miss it for several nights. Prescription that they give emergency situation in children in schools.
Chloral hybrid?
No, if you can put them out, it's slipping my mind. Very low dose. I can break the tablet in half. Like one of the things
The ideal thing is to try to use as little as possible most of the time.
Right.
So when you have a change in your situation, you have some things you can do to implement to make your sleep better. And having tools individual to you really is a discussion you have with your physician, because it has to be taken in context with your other medical issues.
The insurance companies won't even cover it. It's that one that says so, even the more formularies and everything. This was not allowed to be covered.
Not sure what it is, but yes.
I don't want to discourage anybody, but I've been diagnosed on a disability for chronic fatigue for 18 years. And I have, I've gone pretty much the gamut over the years. I've done the sleep test, I've been on almost every one of these things. At one point, I was on so many things, and I've been on constant physician care the whole time. But at one point, chronic fatigue almost killed me, and it wasn't chronic fatigue, it was the medications. What I have learned is that what I can survive on, maintain, and accomplish the most with the least amount of medications. But at one point, I ballooned up in size, my heart enlarged. I went to a heart physician for 6 months. He told me not to come back, I'd be dead in 6 months. I went cold turkey on all this stuff, which you don't do, is you go crazy and your family wants to get rid of you. But I lost 45 pounds in 3 months, and that was enough to make a difference.
Yeah. You know, I think that's really important. Thank you for sharing that. And that is, this happens to the patient and also happens to the physicians. And that is, we want so badly to try to improve your symptoms that we get a little overzealous with medicines. And you feel frightened by your symptoms and you want to have a sense of control over them. The problem is they're pervasive chronic symptoms. So you don't want to over-medicate. And I think sometimes we, in our enthusiasm to try to control them, we use more medicines than we should. And I would caution you to just judge your own situation, right? And not be too much involved in someone else's situation that they have worked on and they're working on. This is really for you to think about for yourself. But I also agree with that, that over time, it's important to kind of get a set of rhythm with your illness and to try to pull back on the medicine and rely less and less on drugs if you can, because they all bring their baggage. There's a point at which you can be rescued by these medicines and they really help pull you out of a very horrible place where you don't have a sense of control and the symptoms are ravaging you. But as you develop a companionship with this chronic problem, you want to try to be as healthy as you can and move away from using any more medicines than you need. Now I want to kind of move through some of these extra slides because I want to talk specifically about other problems that interfere with sleep and think about them for a minute just so that we have a little different angle of these different table legs, and then we'll go with some more questions. So the first one is that if your mood is not stable, it's going to negatively impact your sleep. And with this illness comes a very fragile emotional state. I think you all know that. Your body is not resilient for stress. And when things happen, you can't always let them go. You know, the mind, it takes it to bed. Your mind goes over things. And the whole autonomic nervous system is upregulated. And your body just doesn't deal with stressors as well. So again, I think you need to think very hard about your mental health, how you're coping with stress. You know, if you're suffering from anxiety or depression, if you have a tendency to bipolar illness, because getting those things under better control is going to help your sleep. Not only that, those are the medicines you should be using primarily that will help your sleep, if you choose medicines that will help both problems. And again, medicines are not always the answer. I've learned, it's been really good. Someone gave me, do you know Stuart Drescher? He's the psychologist on our board, and Stuart is just incredible. But before our last big conference, not the one in September, but the one a year before that, I was so stressed and we had so much going on. And he signed me up for this mindfulness meditation class for medical providers. I thought, oh, I don't have time for this. I'm too busy. I'm too stressed. How am I going to fit this in my schedule? And once a week for 8 weeks before the conference, I went to this mindfulness meditation and I learned some really important principles. Now, when I wake up in the middle of the night and my mind is churning over something that happened in the office or somebody I'm worried about, you know what? I click into those techniques I learned in that mindfulness meditation class, and I can shut down those thoughts temporarily, and I'm very often successful at going back to sleep when otherwise I would have got up and taken an Ambien. Does that make sense? So you do not have to rely on drugs. You can learn other ways of taking care of mental health problems. It just depends on their severity and how they're impacting you. But that's a good thought. I know sometimes when you feel better, you feel almost euphoric. But if it goes to the point where you're doing things you shouldn't, or it's keeping you up all night, Are you trying to make up for lost time by doing 3 days worth of work in 1 day? That is not good. And that borders on, yep, on being hypomanic and maybe inappropriate. Yes. No, Cymbalta is, she said, would Cymbalta fall in that category? Cymbalta is an antidepressant. Well, yes, it's not a mood stabilizer. It would help if depression or anxiety were driving your sleep disorder and making it hard to relax at night. People who are bipolar actually can become more manic on an antidepressant without a mood stabilizer. It's something we've learned in the last decade, that when you put people who have a bipolar type depression on SSRIs or SNRIs like Cymbalta, you can actually create worse irritability and worse problems. So the thinking has shifted quite a bit about bipolar biochemistry, which is why I think everybody should be aware of their family history and what kind of genes you have, because even if you don't have a frank bipolar disorder, you may tend toward that kind of a mood disorder and respond to medicines in a different way than other people. Let's see. You know, one reason it's important to recognize this is we have pretty good tools for treating mental health, pretty good tools for anxiety and depression and bipolar. So if we're neglecting what we need to do for that, we're missing a big ingredient in helping control the fatigue and the pain of fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue. Okay, the next little focus is how pain itself can be a sleep disruptor. So it's really important to think about, is pain the thing that's keeping you from not sleeping? And this is just an example of collecting symptoms in my patient. You can see this person has a lot of fatigue, a lot of pain, and a lot of problems with their sleep. And that might be someone who needs to, we need to analyze their pain problem. This is a list of the kind of pain problems I see in our patients that aren't really the same as their fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia is a change in the way the brain produces pain. A change, a shift in the way the brain takes in sensory information, takes it up to the brain, amplifies it, processes it, and sends it out to the body as a pain signal. So it amplifies pain, and you become sensitive and tender, and everything that can hurt hurts worse. Well, if you've got one of these problems underlying it, it amplifies these too. But the difference is, these things sometimes have a different treatment approach than the one we do for fibro. For example, if you have osteoarthritis, anti-inflammatories might help your pain, whereas they're really not helpful for fibromyalgia pain. So they see what, and if you've got a lumbar disc problem that's keeping you awake, it's possible you can see a specialist, get some kind of a procedure, you know, have some kind of an intervention that doesn't wash your whole body with drugs, right? That can improve that pain problem and help you sleep. Same with your greater trochanters being sore, or you know, people's arms going numb at night, or whatever, peripheral neuropathy. Each one of these different pain problems can interrupt sleep, and each one has a different approach to treatment. So teasing apart your pain and having a discussion with your medical providers about your pain can sometimes be helpful in improving the quality of your sleep. The last thing I wanted to talk about individually was fitness. And again, I want to emphasize that if you're not pacing your activity appropriately, you're going to have worse symptoms and worse sleep. Either direction, if you do too much, it's going to disrupt your sleep. And if you're never doing anything, it's going to disrupt your sleep. You know, they did an experiment with well people who were regular exercisers, and they had them abruptly cease their exercise. And within a week, they had developed symptoms similar to fibromyalgia. Stiffness, pain, sleep disruption, body aches, and fatigue. So keeping the body moving, stretching, doing as much strengthening and activity as you can within the limits of your illness without triggering worse symptoms is a very important but tricky endeavor, but super important. I think most of us err on the side of not doing enough because the symptoms are so, you know, devastating, and the rebound is frightening, and you want to avoid having relapse symptoms and rebound. But I'd just like to encourage you all to think about what you can do to stay strong and flexible and try to move and do as much as you can do without triggering worse symptoms. Okay.
when you say exercise, I mean, every time somebody calls for a study, you know, it seems like they're talking a treadmill. I mean, for most people I know, it's like just, you know, grocery shopping, laundry. And I'm not trying to be negative because I used to be really active, so I don't understand the exercise. If it was just exercise, it would be a good life, you know?
Well, the way I look at it is, you do what you can do every day, okay? Yeah. That's your daily activity.
Okay.
And if you have this much to do every day,
right,
that is going to be your level of fitness.
Okay.
And by the time the day is over, you have hit the wall, right?
Right.
Because you have expended everything you have. If possible, you should try to increase your fitness a little bit above what your daily activities require. Does that make sense? You want to be a little stronger than what your daily activities require of you. Now, someone has a stroke, you know, we individually work on their muscles. And I know, believe me, I know as well as all of you sitting in the room, that there are strict limitations to how much you can do when you have this illness. But I have people who have systematically worked on their conditioning. And to do that, this varies from person to person. For some people, that might be, you know, 5 minutes of strengthening. And for other people, they can push the envelope a little bit more. And sometimes you have to vary it depending on what other activities you do or what your status is. You know, if you're in a better phase or in a worse phase. But I do think the concept, your level of fitness will gradually diminish to whatever your daily activity level is. So if you can be systematic about strengthening your core body muscles, about strengthening your individual muscles, and keeping your ability to do enough walking to do the things you need to do, at a minimum, you'll be better off than if you do nothing. For people who are required to put out a certain amount, let's say someone who has a job, and they just expend everything they have in their job. Sometimes it's just not possible for them to do anything more. But I just want you to know that it will, you know, it doesn't improve pain to be fit with these illnesses. It does improve your function, your stability, your limitations, your fall risk, your ability to carry yourself around. Usually fatigue is a little bit better and your mental health is better and sleep is better when you're doing a little bit, and I'm talking about an appropriate level of exercise for your specific condition, not anybody else's paradigm. Yes?
I just have a comment that really helped me on that. I find that people with chronic fatigue, including me, especially me, try to fix too many things at once, just pick one thing, get real consistent about it, get to where it's one of those ADL type things, and then at that point when it's consistent, then move on to something else.
It's true, you've got to take it in little bites. And exercise does not necessarily mean getting on a treadmill. You know, it might mean, and I, you know, encourage people to do things lying down and seated, and to do it for very small increments. And the rule of exercise in my book is never have payback the next day. You should do the amount of exercise that causes no consequence the next day for you. And you got to figure out what that amount is, and it might vary from day to day.
Now, how do you do that and try to lose weight at the same time? Can I ask? Because, you know, I mean, some of us want to, you know, either in the wintertime, sometimes you get up a little bit, like 5 or 10 pounds from the holidays, and you want to lose it. So you're doing all these workout videos and these dance videos and things that you end up paying for tremendously, you know, the next day or several days. How do you balance that and losing weight?
I'm going to tell you something you don't want to hear.
Uh-oh.
And notice I did not say that exercise will help you lose weight. When I said the benefits of exercise, I'm going to tell you, you cannot exercise enough to lose weight. Period. You know, if you exercised an hour, you might burn off 300 calories. Right? How long does it take to eat 300 calories? Okay, so I would not look at exercise as a way of losing weight. You tone. You're stronger, you carry yourself around better.
So just yoga.
You have a little better metabolic rate, it helps you sleep. There's only one real way to lose weight.
And that's eating less.
It has all to do with the type of food and the amount of food you eat. It's good to exercise, but if you expect the exercise to make you lose weight, it's going to disappoint you. It's just not going to work.
I actually lost 50 pounds in a year.
That's great.
And I gained 10 over the winter, you know, just the holiday season, and I'm just trying really hard to lose that 10, so I'm back where I was, but I ended up paying for it.
And yeah, remember what I said? What's the golden rule of exercise?
Right.
Do not do the amount of exercise that gives you consequence. There is a study going on up at the U right now. Anybody wants to volunteer, you can let me know, but you have to exercise on a bicycle for 25 minutes. And if anybody went to the September conference, Kathy presented some of this early data, but we can measure in CFS fibro patients the damage, essentially, from exercise. We don't know what we're measuring yet. We're measuring, you know, autonomic receptors and cytokines and certain pain and fatigue receptors. It doesn't show at all in the controls, and they just tested a group of MS patients, and they don't have it either. And the people we tested with CFS, you can see these levels rise within a few hours of exercise, and some of them are not even starting to go down at 48 hours. So you are, if it feels like you're harming yourself with excessive exercise, you might be. So I'm not telling you to do something that gives you consequence. I'm telling you to find a way to be as fit as you can with your illness. Do not give it up. Because the better you do, the better your illness will be.
Avoid overexertion.
But why are all the studies though? What I want to know, why are they all, every time, again, they're all on a treadmill?
They're not all on a treadmill.
Okay, but, the only ones I keep hearing about are, I guess.
But the study, remember we're talking about a large group of people, and I'm going to tell you there's a clear spectrum of illness in terms of exercise tolerance. And on one end are people I would call CFS patients that have, they're just broken, you know, they exercise and they get sicker. And on the other end are people with what I would call more pure fibro, which they can't exercise intensely or long, but the better fit they are, the more they exercise, the better they feel, to be honest. And if they get motivated and start working and gradually increasing their fitness, they have a curve of gradual improvement that has no end, as long as they're not excessive. So everyone is different. This is not one illness. So and I'm going to tell you, the reason we're using a treadmill in this study at the U is we're looking for the stressor that creates the disease marker. So we know that exercise causes these markers. We're not doing it to condition people, right? We're doing it to try to elicit the one thing everybody complains about, which is when they do activity, they're sick. And never before have there been any diagnostic tests that we could show that show that people have post-exertional malaise. So it's kind of a hard consequence. I think once we understand it, we won't do it anymore. I think it'll be unethical to exercise people just, you know, to make them sick just to do diagnostic studies. So we'll get our data, and then we'll publish it, and then we won't do it anymore. It's hard to make progress.
Well, what is the thing that you're finding? I don't understand.
Well, we're just looking at, it's hard to explain right now, but we're looking at a number of markers in the blood that are on a research basis. They're not really available in a regular lab. But they're potential markers that we might be able to use as a diagnostic test and to try to understand what's going on better in the illness.
To diagnose the disease?
Maybe.
Because stress my body for nothing, just to do it, to stress, that does make me sick, but if I'm actually accomplishing something, I feel way better.
Yeah, well, I'm just going to say everyone's different, and I want to tell you, I have patients that when all we do is treat their pain, they can do almost anything. That it's all pain-based, and that when you get the pain under control, I have a young person who was taking 30 Lortab a day when she came to my office, she was self-medicating. And we, over a period of about 2 years, we gradually sorted out what was going on with her, studied her sleep, got her on, you know, better pain modulators, and eventually, and she was very, very ill and incapacitated. Now she runs 3 miles a day, not every day, not fast, but she's a regular runner, and she has a very full function and almost no symptoms on her meds. So I'm just saying, and really what we did in her case was we treated her pain a little differently than she was treating it when she came to see me, and we discovered that she had a terrible sleep disorder. You'd never know it. She was skinny and 30-something, and she had horrible sleep apnea. And when we finally figured it out and got it treated, everything started turning around and her pain management got better, and then she started to be able to exercise. So on a case-by-case basis, we try to get to the bottom of what might be driving the illness. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about with individual aspect was really treating fatigue. And when we when we try to treat fatigue is when we really mess up sleep, okay? So we use Wellbutrin and Provigil and Adderall and Ritalin and these medicines that directly, you know, jack up your energy. These are the ones that can really mess up your sleep. So be careful when you use them. I had someone come in today who is young, and he was taking, his other doctor was prescribing Effexor, which was very helpful for him. It's an antidepressant. And then put him on Adderall, which I would say is a good medicine. But they kept increasing and increasing his doses, and he was telling me that he wasn't sleeping very well. And he was on 20 milligrams of Adderall three times a day, or four times a day. So he's like on 80 milligrams of Adderall. And we looked up the half-life, and the half-life of Adderall is 10 hours. So 10 hours after his morning dose, he still has half the Adderall in his system. And we had done a sleep study on him, and not surprisingly, he had no stage 3 and 4 sleep, and he had mild clonus. You know, his legs were jumping all night, and he could, you know, we destroyed the effort to treat his fatigue had completely destroyed all of his sleep architecture. So I'm just saying, it's difficult. We do use medicines to treat all aspects of the of your syndrome, but when you just look at sleep, you realize that almost everything you do might impact your sleep in a negative way. So this is just kind of a quick summary list of many of those medicines we talked about, and maybe we can, wow, is it really 8:23?
Yes.
Holy cow. Okay, so I think we better, maybe we just take a couple of questions, and we usually end at 8:30 anyway, I guess. So any other pressing questions? Important questions, and we've really answered them all. Okay, well, what I'd like you to do is think about your own sleep and all these aspects of things we think might impact your sleep and work on it and see if you can improve the quality of your sleep in non-pharmacologic ways and maybe improve the way you take your medicines so that your sleep has better quality. And I hope that's helpful for you. And thanks for coming.